to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Oh, how sweet.
Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Oh, yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus. Come on, sing that.
Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease. Just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
I'm so glad I learned to trust him. Come on, let me hear you.
I'm so glad I learned to trust him, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that he is with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I pray him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus,
how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Isn't it great to know we can trust Jesus when everybody else lets us down? We can trust in him this morning. Hey, won't you take a moment, turn around, welcome some folks to our service, make them feel at home. Let's continue to worship the Lord this morning. Sing about amazing grace.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Come on.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. And who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
All that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. Oh, you're worthy, Lord. You're worthy. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Come on, sing that.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy. Worthy, worthy, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
All that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. I'll thank him this morning with a clapped hand for that amazing, wonderful, life-changing grace that he gives us. Amen? You can be seated.
Well, good morning, Thomas Terrace Church. Apparently, I didn't get the memo that our sweaters weren't supposed to have sleeves today. I don't understand, but it's weird. It's weird. Do what you do you, man. You do you. We want to make everybody feel welcome here at Thomas Terrace. We're so glad that you're here with us this Sunday morning. If you're visiting with us, I would ask you to do us a favor. In the pew back in front of you, there's a guest information card. If you could fill that card out and drop it in one of the offering boxes as you leave today, we would really appreciate it to give us a record of your attendance and allow us to pray for you individually. If you want to do it through your smartphone, you just flip it over, scan it with your camera, and it'll take you to an online guest information card electronically, and then you can do it that way. Or you can text the word CONNECT to the church number at 434-993-3777, and then you'll get a link back. You click that link, and it takes you to that same electronic guest information card. You can also give electronically today at myttbc.com/give. You can go to the website, click the little drop-down menu, and you can give securely that way. You can also mail your tithes and offerings to the church address at P.O. Box 965 in Concord, Virginia. Or again, we have little offering boxes stationed by all the exits for your convenience. You can drop your tithes and offerings in there as you're leaving today. Tonight at 5 p.m., we will have our first Sunday prayer fellowship in the lobby. So participate in that. Please be out here in the lobby classroom at 5 p.m. tonight. Tonight also at 6 p.m., we will have our fourth quarter financial report. This meeting is open to all church members, and all church members are encouraged to come and participate in that to prop up Don Leslie a little bit. That's his glory for every quarter. You know, every 3 months he gets to stand up and talk, and he loves it. It's mind-numbingly boring to me, but guys who are financial guys, like they jump up and down when they talk about finances. Woo! Budgets! Yay! No. Our Good News Club ministry, which meets after school at Concord Elementary School, will resume tomorrow. This club meets at 3:30 to 5:30 every Monday through March 20th. If you'd like to serve in this ministry, please see Christine Harp or Earl Harp, and they will give you some information on that. In addition to the Good News program, we will continue to provide food items for the school backpack program. We have been informed that the supply of food is getting low, and there is a need for more food items. If you'd like to bring food for this program, there's a drop-off box and a list of requested items by the welcome desk. In addition, Christine Harp would like me to share a few thoughts. So we have fed 15 students every week since August 31st. Also, the Thursday night ladies' Bible study members provided each of the students and their families with a complete Thanksgiving dinner the week of Thanksgiving. Additionally, we have had several families continue to help with needed items, and we and the families are so grateful. We're so thankful to be a part of this generous, loving church family. We have heard from the school personnel that the families are very thankful and they appreciate the help so much. We have included information and cards from our church several times along with the food. Also, please pray that the children and their families will come to know Jesus or come to know him more through this ministry. And thank you for everyone who participates and helps with being the hands and feet of Jesus. Amen. This Saturday is our Rekindle event. Today's the last day to sign up, so if you're planning on signing up and you have not done so, get in my hands or in one of the other leaders' hands a completed form. The cost is $40. That covers your main meal, it covers your dessert, it covers your appetizer, doesn't cover your dancing, that's free. So it's gonna be a lot of fun. We're gonna have a photo booth where you're gonna take a picture with your significant other, and you'll get an 8x10 nice professional grade photo, and it's gonna be a lot of fun. If you have any questions about that, myself, Melissa Foster, we'll be around after service, so you can come ask any questions about that, and we'll be happy to answer them. But again, today's the last day. We're driving food right now for it, so we need a good count by the end of today. And the students who are within the sound of my voice, be here tonight for a dress rehearsal practice. We're going to meet in the children's check-in area. And we're gonna do a dry run there without the food, okay? So we might have a snack or something for you, but there'll be no smoked pork chop. All right, so lastly, as you know, there are several Bible studies that meet during the week, and one of those is Tuesday night men's Bible study. That meets in the Thomas Terrace, Thomas Building Man Cave, which is the basement over here on the right side. This is led by Glenn Williamson, and he would like to show you this short video.
Bible study because of its simple format and its scripture-based only. The men's Bible study has enlarged my understanding of faith and how central it is to my daily walk. I've been really enjoying it.
I've been enjoying men's Bible study. I like the camaraderie, the prayer meeting where we can bring in our prayer requests and the fellowship with the other saints. It's been good.
I've enjoyed the Discovery Bible Study. It brings men together to pray together
open God's Word. We usually dissect several verses and go through it several times and glean everything that we can and to use the scriptures to help us in our walk with the Lord.
I really am fortunate that I get to participate in the men's Bible study. I do my studying at home alone, but when I get in the group, I get a further understanding of the scriptures we read. And if there's an area that I'm weak in, the others that participate help to clear that up for me or further along. And we each grow by helping each other studying these words. It's wonderful when you walk away from here and the Word of God has been clarified and built up in you. You'll really enjoy coming to our Bible study.
When you receive God working in an area, join Him. And that's what we've done as a group. It's not just limited to us guys. I hope that maybe you.
Thank you, choir. Awesome song. Lyrics written by Dottie Rambo. And the words, she wrote the lyrics. The music was Old Danny Boy. I don't know who wrote that one, some Irishman somewhere. And it's a secular song, isn't it? Yeah. And we're singing it in church. Kind of like that dancing they're going to do Friday night. I can't believe Baptists are Baptists don't dance. Somebody told me a joke for church. I won't say it in here. But wasn't that, where'd he go to? Matt went back to the nursery. I think Matt told me, he says he's going to tell it Friday night. So, or Saturday night, or whenever we're going to be here for this, you just be sure and come. It's going to be a great time. Well, we have a few birthdays this weekend. In fact, a couple of weeks ago, I think Judy Baker, not even a couple of weeks ago, just about a week and a half ago, Judy Baker had a birthday. She's not telling anybody how old she is, but she is 10 years older than Renee, and Renee is 68. So she's 10 and a half years older, so you do the math. Sam said he married an old woman. And I'm not saying. Then, of course, Michelle Reese had a birthday on Friday, and we're not talking about her age. I have no clue, and I've never, ever asked her. Now, that's unusual. I usually ask everybody. If I ask your age, I'm not being rude. I just want to know how old you are. Then I thought, it's just a number, folks. I mean, I know these people that lie about their age because they're scared of getting old. You're going to get old anyhow, so don't lie about it. And let's see. Also, Joyce Leslie had a birthday on Friday as well. Where are you at, Joyce? I saw you. There she is. And Don told me that she is also 79. She said it. She didn't want me to say it, so she said it. So I want to say happy birthday to all of you, dear ladies. Okay, now, anybody else had a birthday just so I don't get in trouble? Lois Smith had a birthday, and Paul had a birthday, huh? Yours is tomorrow, and you'll be 35. Huh? Just a little bit. 39, I get it, 39. And holding. Okay, who else over here? Nanette, it's your birthday today. Well, happy birthday today. And it's good to see y'all back in church today. Somebody told me y'all was traveling to these golf tournaments and bowling tournaments somewhere. Is that right? You know your buddy tells on you every time you do that. Okay. That's being what we call being accountable to one another, amen? That's what the Bible says. We're just doing what the Bible says. Okay, we have a number of prayer requests on our prayer list today. The family of Clyde Johnson, this is Margaret Tucker's brother. Second brother in a matter of 2 weeks' time that she lost. And we've been to two funerals for that family. And just remember Margaret and her family in prayer. This is a very difficult time. He was kind of a favorite of the uncles and of all the family. And pray for him. Pray for them. He's in heaven. He's got it made. Also, pray for Sandy Spear. She has glaucoma. She has to put drops in her eyes ever so often for what's happening. She needs your prayers. Pray for David Roop. David Roop is in stage 5 kidney failure, and they put a port in him for the dialysis when I was there on Thursday, I guess it was, when I was there Thursday afternoon with him. He's discouraged, to say the least. He's in a lot of pain. He really needs your fervent prayers. Then pray for William Fike, a friend of Betty and David Kemp in Roanoke, with sepsis, kidney damage, very high blood pressure. He needs your prayers. Also, Abby and Kylie, Abby Wright and Kylie Adams, 6 and 7 year old girls, both who have cancer, friends of Sam Driscoll. And then James and Debbie Phillips, they have COVID. They're not with us today. Jason Wilson, who plays our guitar, all of our instrumentalists, a lot of people are out with COVID. Lula Ann Hale is suffering from COVID. Billy Hunt, Nancy Hunt's 98-year-old father-in-law has COVID. He's at Lynchburg General Hospital. And Judy Baker has COVID. All of these people suffering with COVID. This is probably the worst outbreak we've seen in our church since COVID hit some time ago. But we do mitigate the buildings and what have you, so it should be, it's safe in here, but it's still, you can get it at Walmart, you can get it anywhere you go. And some people are kind of immune to it. I'm around it all the time. My wife had it. She fixed my meals. We slept in the same bed, and still I didn't get it. So I'm a blessed person. But some of you, you know, the wind blows your direction. You get it. I pray for you, and we'll pray for these dear folks also. Another real serious prayer request. Temple Baptist Church in Madison Heights, Virginia, is going through a very difficult time. I don't know any of the details, and I'm not interested in the details. It's none of our business. But they're having a very difficult time. And it is incumbent upon us as fellow believers in the Lord Jesus Christ in a sister church to that church that we pray for them. It's not easy when church has troubles. And when it affects them, it affects us all because we are joined together as the body of Christ. And we need each other. And we're in this together with them. And we need to pray that God will get all the glory and the grace and the praise out of what's happening. And like I said, I don't know the details. I'm not interested. Don't come try to tell me because I'm not interested. All I know is that they've requested prayer, and so we'll be praying for them. Let's stand together as we quote our memory verse together for today. And those who know your name will put their trust in you. For you, Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Psalm 9:10. Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of grace. We thank you for your amazing grace. We thank you that, Lord, it is indeed so amazing that we can't even begin to comprehend it. Lord, you reach down and touch us with your mercy every day. It's new every morning, so we praise you today. We've come to worship you. We've come to pray. We've come to bring our request to you. And Lord, we know that you're a God who answers prayer. We've watched you do it time and again here. I pray, Lord, that you'll put your hand of protection on this church from the COVID bug, that you'll keep our members safe. Lord, that you'll rid this virus from the world as it has become a plague for the world. And I pray, Father, that you would bring a healing touch to those, Lord, it is in your will to heal, and we'll give you glory and honor. Lord, I pray for this service today that we'll be open and responsive to the still small voice of the Spirit of God as you speak to us today for what we need to be doing and how we need to be, Lord, exalting your name everywhere we go. And Father, we'll thank you. Now, Lord, bless this service in a special way. Be with these folks that we've asked for their requests, Lord, that you would touch them and heal them. Glorify yourself in all that's said and done. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, yes. You may remain standing.
Remain standing as we continue to worship the Lord. Let's sing this next song. Our focus has been about Jesus and what he did for us on the cross. So let's cast our mind back about what he did for us on Calvary.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample sting, the angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing. Shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, oh Lord our God.
Sing it again.
We thank you, Lord. We thank you for what you did on Calvary for us. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
And all God's people said, amen. Amen. 1970, Bill and Gloria Gaither wrote a song entitled, There's Just Something About That Name. The backstory for that song was that both sets of their grandparents had recently passed away. And they noted that their grandparents, even in their dying days, spoke often about the name of Jesus. They kept whispering his name, Jesus. Also around that time, they became parents and weren't so sure they were up to the task or what kind of future their children might face. They were going through, and we'd just finished the turbulent 60s. When one of their children woke up with a high fever in the middle of the night, they began immediately calling on the name of Jesus, the great physician, because, yes, there is something about that name. Thus, the inspiration for this powerful Wonderful song. There is authority in that name. There is something about it, and it carries with it a great deal of authority. If I were to go to London, England today, go down to number 9 or number 10 Downing Street, walk into the offices of the residents and Prime Minister of Great Britain and started barking out orders regarding state and national security, they would not only have me arrested, but those orders would be completely ignored. Why? Because my name has no authority there. But when Prime Minister Rishi Sunak issues an executive order, the wheels of government immediately go into action because his name carries with it the authority to wield the power to make such a command. The name of the Lord Jesus has all the authority of the universe behind it, for he is the Son of the living God. Jesus declared about that authority, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. And that's because his name, as the Apostle Paul states, is a name that's above every name. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Of those in heaven, of those on earth, and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And today, his name deserves our adoration, our worship, and our obedience. Now here in the third chapter of the book of Acts, we find a powerful witness of the authority and more just in the name of Jesus. And it is as available today to us as it was to the apostles in the book of Acts over 2,000 years ago. How did they exercise the power found in the name of Jesus? Well, in this chapter we find out the how and the why. First, there was praying in the name of Jesus. Look at verse 1. Now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. You know, just about in all the Gospels, it's always Peter, James, and John. But in this instance, and from this point on, you usually see Peter and John together. Ironically, because they are polar opposites. John was kind of a high-minded person, a deep thinker. He was kind of he was the nice guy. Peter was foot and mouth disease. I mean, if it came into his mind, it came out of his mouth, right or wrong. Sometimes he was right, a lot of times he was wrong. But he's the man who, you know, when it came down to walking on the water, he asked Jesus when he saw him, "Can I come?" Nobody else asked. Everybody says, "Well, look at poor Peter. He lost his faith. Well, look at Peter. He walked on water." Have you walked on water lately? Oh, Peter, he walked on the water until he took his eyes off Jesus. You know, we always get in deep water when we get our eyes off Jesus. And John, he was the one who gave us the great, most prophetic book in the Bible, the book of Revelation. He was a deep thinker. He was a wonderful man, the beloved one. He's the one who would lay his head on Jesus' breast. Peter was just the opposite, kind of obnoxious in a lot of ways, irritating a lot of people. But isn't it interesting how God chose him to be the spokesman on the day of Pentecost? Isn't it interesting that God chose him to do great and mighty works? In fact, half the book of Acts is about the exploits of this man called Peter. But here he is with his companion John. Two opposites went up to the temple to pray. It says that it was at the ninth hour in most of the translations of the Bible, which was really just 3 o'clock in the afternoon. It was a traditional prayer hour for the Jewish people. Now, even though Peter and John were now a part of this new thing called the church, they still maintained their connection with the spiritual activities of their cultural religion. When Jesus was calling out the hypocrisy of the scribes and the Pharisees, he told his disciples, listen to this, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat," meaning they're the ones in authority over the temple. "Therefore, whatever they tell you to observe, that observe and do." They tell you to do it, you do it. "But do not do according to their works, for they say and do not do." Therefore, Peter and John were observing the hour of prayer, which was part of the tradition. But there was probably even a more compelling reason for which they went at that hour, because it was upon that hour which Jesus cried out on the cross, "It is finished." An atonement for sin had been made. So they went to pray in that name that's above all names, the name of Jesus. If you remember the account of Daniel in the lion's den, the other leaders and the rulers in the kingdom of Darius devised a scheme to get rid of the righteous Daniel by tricking the king to sign an unalterable decree that anyone who prayed to another god other than the king was to be thrown into the den of lions. You remember the story. They were so jealous that the Bible says that they sought to find some charge against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could find no charge or fault because he was faithful, nor was any error found or fault found in him. Whew, I wonder how many of us have that testimony. I mean, they did a deep dive into this man's life, and they couldn't find a single thing against this man. He was so squeaky clean. His impeccable character was so pure, they had to concoct a diabolic scheme to get rid of him, and they did. Now, here's what I want you to notice. Go down to verse 10 of that book in Daniel, and you'll read, it says, "Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went home." Now remember, this is the number two man in the kingdom. He's the prime minister of all of Babylon. Everybody answered to Daniel. And in his upper room, with his windows open toward Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees three times that day and prayed and gave thanks before his God. And listen to this, as was his custom since early days. Do you see that? He prayed three times a day, morning, noon, and night, to his God, the one, the only true and living God. He respected the king. He was honorable to the king, but he didn't pray to the king because the king wasn't his God. Now notice also that Daniel's window and where it was open toward. It was open toward Jerusalem. Why? Well, you have to go even further back into the Old Testament to when Solomon was the king of Israel. After he had completed building of the magnificent temple in Jerusalem, he dedicated it to God. And Solomon prayed that if the children of Israel turned from God and were taken into captivity, that if they remembered God, and this is what he said, where they have been carried captive and pray toward their land, which you gave to their fathers, the city which you have chosen, and toward the temple which I have built for your name, then hear from heaven your dwelling place, their prayer and their supplication, and maintain their cause and forgive your people who have sinned against you. That's exactly what Daniel was doing. He was obeying that prayer that Solomon had prayed some hundreds of years before. If you go to Jerusalem today, this is interesting. There's a huge, massive stone wall surrounding the Temple Mount. And on any given day, you'll find Orthodox Jews and even tourists at the wall. It's called the Wailing Wall or the Western Wall. And it's facing the former temple site. And doing so, they pray for the peace of Jerusalem and the coming of Messiah, the Anointed One. That's what the name Christ means, Anointed One. They write their prayers out on little pieces of paper and they stuff them in the cracks in the between the stones. And you see hundreds of thousands of little pieces of paper balled up and rolled up. And these are prayers that these people have placed in that wall praying for the peace of Jerusalem. And one day there will be peace when the Prince of Peace marches through the Eastern Gate that'll be open for the first time in over 1,000 years when King Jesus walks in and they'll finally have peace. But there's a ways to come for that. Aware of Solomon's prayer and Daniel's practice, Peter and John, following a spiritual tradition, made their way up to the temple to pray at the appointed time. But unlike the Orthodox Jews, they came to pray in the name of Jesus. For Jesus had said, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it, in John 14, 14. And that's exactly what they were coming to the temple to do. As they were about to enter the temple for prayer meeting and for a prayer, a ministry opportunity arose. It popped up right before them, which led to a supernatural healing in the name of Jesus. Look at it here in verse 2. It says, and a certain lame man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms or money from those who entered the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for the money. And fixing his eyes upon him with John, Peter said, look at us. So he gave them his attention, and expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have. He had to be a Baptist. But what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. I love that. He said, I don't have any money, but what I have, here I give. How often have we missed opportunities just like that to see God at work because we're too busy? We're in too much of a hurry to stop and take the time to talk to somebody that needs us. Here, Peter and John were minding their own business, heading to a spiritual meeting when God interrupted their plans. And by, of all things, a beggar, an old beggar. Peter and John could have ignored him and walked on by just as everyone else was doing. It was the hour of prayer. So many people were walking through the gate called Beautiful. A few may have even thrown some conscience money at this old man, but probably just ignored him and kept going. But not Peter and John. They were being led by the Spirit because they were walking in the Spirit. They didn't see this as an irritating interruption. And I wonder where they learned that from. Do you remember they were with Jesus, and oftentimes they would try to shield him from a lot of the activities that were going on in the surrounding areas. And there was a man called blind Bartimaeus, and he started screaming out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And everybody tried to say, hey, shut up. He ain't got time for you. What did Jesus do? He stopped wherever it was he was going, and he walked over to that man, and he touched his eyes, and the man could see for the first time in his life. It was a miracle. Opportunities we miss often simply because we don't take the time to help some poor person. And we often see them as an irritation. I was walking out of General Hospital the other day. And of course, I wear my clergy badge because they did away with those things, but I still have mine because I've had it for umpteen hundred years. But they did away with it and told us to get rid of them. I'm not, because even now when I walk in there, if I've got it on, I don't have to stand in that line to get a visitor badge. I just go there and shake it and go. I love that. And I go in the emergency room, and you say, do you use special prep? You bet your boots I do. So anyway, they put... I go in the emergency room, and that poor lady standing right at that door, she's there just about all the time I go in there. She says, oh, I'll take you. Do you know where you're going? I said, yeah. She says, I'll take you back there. I have to bypass everything. She opens the door for me. So that little badge, there's authority in a name. There's an authority in that badge. And so she let me go in there. Well, anyway, I was leaving the hospital and still had the badge on. I usually don't take it off until I get in the car and then throw it into my console. But anyway, I was wearing it, and this guy stops me as I'm walking to the car, and it's raining outside, and so I really didn't want to get wet. You know, my hair, it'll melt if it gets wet, and so, you know, the snow on the roof, it does melt. But anyway, he said, hey, can I talk to you? You're a preacher. I said, yeah, I'm a preacher. He said, well, I was a Muslim. I'm a Christian now. He said, I need to talk to you. Can you talk to me? He said, I can't do it right now, but can you give me a number to call you? And I was thinking about giving him one of my cards, but it's got my cell phone number on it. I don't know, this guy might come and look me up and chop my head off or something like that. So I thought, well, I'm not going to do that. But so I gave him the church number. I figured we could handle him with all of us here together. And so I gave him you're not here this morning, are you? If you are, raise your hand. So I finished telling this story. But anyhow, But anyhow, he said, so anyway, he said, I've really got something serious to talk to you about. And so it's funny because I'd already started preparing this message when this happened. And he said, can I call you? And I came back to the office and I told Lisa, I said, Lisa, we're going to get a phone call. I said, put it on through. This is the guy and what his name. And of course, he had an Arab name and everything. He said, but I am a Christian. I said, okay. So the call finally came in, and sure enough, he was asking for alms, and we took care of him. I don't know if he used it to the praise of the glory of God and grace, but I just know that sometimes our lives get interrupted. We never know when God's going to do something in somebody's life because we took the time to say, hello, how are you? God love you. I'm praying for you. Reminded of a story of a man that was walking into his house one day, just right around Thanksgiving, up in Boston, Massachusetts. And as he was walking up the walk, a man, a UPS driver, just delivered something at his house. And he looked at him and he said, Jesus loves you, and kept walking. This guy looked at him and thought, you know, he didn't go to church, he wasn't religious, you know, that Jesus loves me, just kind of nuts. And so anyway, he went on in his house. They went through the Thanksgiving holidays and everything. And his wife asked him during that time, said, what do you want me to get you for Christmas? And before he knew it, these words came out of his mouth. I want a Bible for Christmas. A what? He said, I want a Bible. You want a what? He said, I want a Bible. And she said, well, why do you want a Bible? He said, I don't know. I just think I need a Bible. He started reading that Bible, and he got saved. Several years later, he surrendered to the call to preach, and I sat on his ordination council and heard him tell his story. Dave, I think you were with me on that trip. We went up there. I read that, and it just blew my mind. He just said, Jesus loves you. There's something about that name. Jesus loves you. Well, Peter and John, they didn't see it as an interruption or an irritating interruption. They simply saw it as an opportunity for God to do the impossible. However, like I said, they had to be Baptists because they didn't have any money. Silver and gold have a none, said Peter, but what I have is a whole lot better than all the money in the world. In the name, in the authority of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Notice the full identification there. Jesus, Savior, the Anointed One of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he not only stood up, but he jumped up. It says he leaped to his feet. I wonder how often God has tried to interrupt our lives and our plans for a supernatural work, and we get bent out of shape and defiant and forge on with our plans, only to miss the miracle or the blessing that he wanted to do in and through us. This happens more often than we think. You see, immediate and absolute obedience to God's word and Holy Spirit's promptings are not optional if we want to join God in the greater works than these. Now, when God works his work in unbelievers and social outcasts, it results in praising the name of Jesus. Look at it in verse 8. So he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. Then they knew it was he who sat begging at alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. You know, every time a soul comes to a saving knowledge and faith in Jesus Christ, a supernatural miracle transpires in their heart and in their soul. It's called many things: a new life, a new birth, a new creation, a new man, a regeneration. It's a miracle. Every time a soul gets saved, it's a miracle. As sinners, we cannot save ourselves any more than this poor lame man could heal his crippled legs. Ah, but there's power in praising the name of Jesus Christ. And when we do, it draws all kind of attention. It says, and all the people saw him walking and praising God, and were all filled with wonder and amazement. You see, when the name of Jesus Christ is highly exalted in the church, then we experience the supernatural church. We want to be a supernatural church. We don't just want to be a normal, everyday, run-of-the-mill, average church. We want a church where the Spirit of God is always active and working and alive. We want to see God do the supernatural. And we've got to not only want to see it, we've got to believe to see it. Because believing is seeing. We believe that there's power in the name of Jesus. Guess what? We'll start seeing power in the name of Jesus. But look at this. They didn't just stop with praising God. They began preaching in the name of Jesus. Look at verse 11. Men of Israel, why do you marvel at this? Or why look so intently at us as though by our own power or godliness we made this man walk? Peter was saying, I'm nothing good. I'm not all that righteous. Hadn't been that long. It hadn't been that long since he denied that he even knew the Lord. And now here he is experiencing the power in the name of Jesus. Then he preaches, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But you denied the Holy One and the just and asked for a murderer to be granted to you and killed the Prince of Life, whom God raised from the dead, of which we are witnesses. Now look closely at verse 16. And his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. Yes, faith comes, which comes through him, has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. Peter preached in the name of Jesus because it's all about Jesus. This crippled man wasn't healed because of what Peter said to him. He was healed because Peter had faith in the name of Jesus. Yes, there is something about that name. And then Jesus gave him the faith to believe because the text says the faith which comes through him. Peter gives all the credit, even his faith, to Jesus to whom it belongs. But then he continued his message to the crowd. And notice that he appealed to their conscience. Look at verse 17. Yet now, brethren, I know that you did it in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But those things which God foretold by the mouth of all of his prophets that Christ would suffer, he has thus fulfilled. Peter understood the spiritual ignorance of their actions in participating with the Romans to crucify Jesus. So he enlightens them regarding the truth of why they did it. It was to fulfill what the prophets had divinely, supernaturally predicted would happen to Jesus. Now, they did that in ignorance, but now, because they know the truth, he commands their repentance. Look at verse 19. Repent, therefore, and be converted that your sins may be blotted out, so that the times of refreshing, that's an interesting phrase there, may come from the presence of the Lord. There Peter is calling for a national repentance. The nation as a whole had rejected their Messiah when he came. And that he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before, whom heaven must receive until the times of restoration of all things, which God has spoken by the mouth of his holy prophets since the world began. Repentance demands a change of mind. They must have a change of heart regarding the truth about Jesus and their part in his crucifixion. Repentance is much more than just feeling sorry for your sins. As one little Sunday school girl put it, it means feeling sorry enough to quit. That's what repentance does. It quits. It turns around. Having regret or remorse for sin or sins is not the same as repentance. Repentance is a complete change of mind about Jesus the Savior and our sins. Now let me ask you this. Have you genuinely repented? Think about it. Then he explains the consequences if you don't. Number one, You can heed the message and repent, then be both blessed and a blessing. Or number two, you can ignore and reject Jesus and be destroyed. Look at what he says here in this next verse. For Moses truly said to the fathers, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. He's talking about Jesus. Him you shall hear in all things, whatever he says to you, and it shall be that every soul who will not hear that prophet, listen to this, shall be utterly destroyed. You don't pay attention to this man called Jesus, then you'll be destroyed from among the people. Yes, and all the prophets from Samuel and those who follow, as many as have spoken, have also foretold these days. You are the sons of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying to Abraham, and in your seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed. To you first, God, having raised up his servant Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning you and turning every one of you from your iniquities. Your iniquities have separated between you and your God and have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. God wants you to turn from your iniquities. Turn to him in repentance and in faith in that name of Jesus. You know, despite all that the nation of Israel did to their Messiah, Jesus prayed, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And if I had the time, I could go into the details of really what he was praying there for them. But he was talking about the time of refreshing. They could have had a national revival at the resurrection of Jesus Christ, but they rejected him. They lied about it. They said he didn't really rise from the dead, even though they knew for a fact he had. They didn't want to believe. People that go to hell today say, well, I just can't believe. I just can't believe. It's impossible for me to believe. No, it's not you can't believe. It's you won't believe. You don't want to believe. And you'll die in your sin and go to hell. You say, well, that's pretty harsh. Well, it's pretty true, though. I love you enough to tell you the truth. I used to tell my kids all the time when they were growing up, this is going to hurt you more than it hurts me. How many of you ever heard that? When you got ready to beat the devil out of them? Sometimes you got to beat the devil out of them. Now, if they pushed my buttons enough, it didn't hurt me as much as it probably hurt them. But anyway, it did. It pained me to have to discipline them. I didn't want to have to discipline them. I think Rachel probably got by with one. Dan might have got by with two. And Chris probably got by with about 10,000. But he loved the attention, and brother, we gave it to him. And bless his heart, it did work, and he turned out okay. But each child is a little bit different. But you know what? God loved the nation of Israel. That's what Peter was telling him, the God of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This is the foundation of our faith. This is our heritage. This is who we come from. This is of whom this nation exists and from whom it exists. We need to receive our Messiah, and they rejected him. And in times of refreshing, you need a revival, Israel. And Israel said no, because Jesus had already told them that there's going to come a time, judgment's coming, because Jesus knew what they were going to do. They weren't going to receive him. He knew because he was God, and he knows the beginning from the end. Now, the point is this. We come to Jesus on his terms and receive eternal salvation, or reject Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord and be eternally damned. That was true for the nation of Israel as a whole and for each of us as individuals. The choice is simple, and both will cost you everything. Receive Christ and you'll lose the world, but you'll win in eternity. Reject Christ and you may win the world, you may, but you'll for certain lose your soul in eternity. Jesus said, for whosoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? You must answer that simple question. Are the gains of this world worth it at the expense of your eternal soul. Are they? Are they? Think about it. Are you living for Jesus? You've been saved. You've been baptized. You know He did a work of regeneration in your life. Who are you living for? You're serving Him. You may never get silver or gold, but boy, you have a lot more than silver or gold can ever buy. You've got the greatest treasure, that treasure in your heart and in your life, Jesus Christ. And let me tell you something, He is worth it all. He is worth it all. These 68 years I've lived and these 48 years I've been in pastoral ministry, I can tell you this, I have absolutely no regrets when it comes down to serving Jesus Christ. There were no heaven or no hell. It's still better than anything this world has to offer. Jesus, there's something special, something powerful about that name. Has that name been applied to your life in salvation? In daily living, why not today? Father in heaven, we come before your throne of grace this morning. Lord, there may be some here today who've heard this so many times, they think they know it by rote, but do they know you by experience? You said in that day, many will say to you, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, do many miracles in your name, and work wonders in your name and signs? And you'll say, depart from me, you work of iniquity, I never knew you. Lord, they may know about you, but they don't know you. And you don't know them as one who has repented of their sins and come by faith to you. And let the power of the name of Jesus wash their sins away and give them eternal life. So, Father in heaven, I pray today that they will humble themselves before you, that we will humble ourselves before you and repent of our sins as a church. Oh, that the supernatural power of God would fall upon this place to affect the lives of all of Central Virginia, that it would affect every other church, that revival would break out here in Central Virginia. Lord, it can, if your people, which are called by your name, will humble themselves and call upon your name, the name of Jesus. It's all about you. It's not about us. Father, I pray that we'll come today and humble ourselves before you for your name's sake and for our eternal sake, in Jesus' name. Let's stand together with heads bowed and eyes closed. If you're here today, you don't know Jesus as your Savior. If you died right now, you don't know where you would spend eternity for sure. You have questions, you have doubts. You may have prayed a sinner's prayer, but will you change? If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. You call upon his name. Did that name do something in your life and in your heart? If it hadn't, you need to come to him today. Our pastors will be here at the front. You come and take them by the hand. Let them know you want to know Jesus. You want to experience the salvation of Jesus Christ today. Will you come? Will you come as we sing? Here today as a believer, are you seizing the moments, the opportunities? Are you making yourself available to be a minister of the name of Jesus, to watch Jesus do something through your life? Are you? Don Perrin was telling me this past week. He's down in Florida right now, but he gave me a call. He was down at the mall over here the other day passing out tracts. And the mall cop came and told him if he wouldn't stop passing out tracts, he'd already passed out about 200. That's probably all that was in the mall. And he passed out all those tracts, and he said, if you don't stop, you'll be banned from the mall forever. And you have to stop passing out tracts now. And then she had the nerve to tell him she was a Christian. I told him I'd Jesus said, if you think you claim the name of Jesus Christ, you could go enforce a stupid rule like this. You don't deserve that name. Shame on you for claiming that name. But anyway, he's out doing what he needs to be doing, and he's doing it unashamedly. I asked him if he left. He said yes. He left. He wasn't going to cause a ruckus. But he did his job in the meantime. You know, they asked Jesus to leave. They tried to run him out of Nazareth, as you remember, when he said, I'm God. They got mad at him and tried to stone him and run him out of town, throw him off of a cliff. Yeah, they're not going to love you, but I'm just telling you. Church, it's time for us to stand up and be the supernatural church instead of this little namby-pamby play church on Sunday morning for an hour. Can't hurry up to get out of here for a ball game or whatever. No, this is serious stuff. Most serious stuff you'll ever experience. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. God speaking to your heart. Will you come right now as we sing?
Home to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely.
General Hospital. Be much in prayer for her surgery, that it'll be a great success. She's here this morning, but you be praying for her. These back surgeries can get tricky, and so pray that it'll be a great success. I'm sure she'll appreciate it very much. Both tonight at 6 o'clock, First Sunday Prayer Fellowship, and we also have an agenda tonight in our prayer fellowship. I want you to come. We're going to be praying for all of our leaders, every single worker at Thomas Terrace Church by name tonight. I want you to come and be a part of this prayer fellowship. And then at 6 o'clock, we'll be having our financial report. And by the way, it's one of the best financial reports I think we've had in probably 10, 15 years. So it's very good. It's an end of the year report from last year, how God has worked and done amazing things. So be back tonight for all of these things. And Awana is at 5:30. And where's that at?
Down in the gym.
Oh, the Grand Prix in the gym. A lot of activity on the campus here tonight. Okay, well, let's close in prayer. And Reverend Pastor Deacon Dick Vannoy. By the way, Dick is our chairman of deacons now. I don't know. He's done it before.
The pay's good.
We tripled it this year.
There's something about that name, and let's pray in His name. Lord Heavenly Father, we thank You for all that You are, all that You do, all that You promise and promises that You keep. Heavenly Father, I pray Your blessings upon each one. I pray You'll touch each heart at that point of most hurt. Lord, healing, comfort, just a leading. Lord, there's something about that name. As I pray so often, Lord, I pray that You'll bless us bless us deeply and richly so that we might be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name, amen.